We need to have that mentality that believes the Bible no matter what. We believe the Word of God. We believe that what was said was true. We believe that what God placed in His Scriptures is exactly what He intended to place in His Scriptures. And now here we are reading a judgment of God, and we have to by default say it's true, it's just, it's righteous, it's perfect, it's pure. It's exactly what God says it would be. There in 1 Peter chapter 2, what we need to do is we need to believe the Scriptures and not stumble at the Scriptures. 1 Peter 2 and verse 6, it says, "Wherefore also it is contained in the Scriptures, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he that believeth on him shall not be confounded." Look at this. The Scriptures, or our King of Kings, our Lord of Lords, is laid as a precious chief cornerstone in Zion. And he says, whosoever believeth on him should not be confounded. We know that the cornerstone, we know that the rock is Christ. And he's referred to as a rock of offense. He offends, even though he's righteous and true and just and pure altogether. Now, we continue on and read, and it says, "Therefore," it says, "unto you therefore which believe, he is precious." And every word of God ought to be the same thing, because he is the Word. The Word was God. The Word was made flesh. And we know that when we behold the Scriptures here in the King James Bible for the English-speaking people, that it is a precious Word. It is a true Word. And we believe on him, therefore he is precious unto us as well. "But unto them which be disobedient," watch this, "the stone which the builders disallowed, the same is made the head of the corner." They're confounded. As we were promised, we should never be confounded if we believe on it. Those that believe not look at something like Deuteronomy 21, and they're instantly offended and confounded and confused as a result. And they disallow that. They reject that. That couldn't be the God that I believe in, the nominal Christian will say. Well, my God is of love. He's the New Testament God, not the Old Testament God. And he wouldn't do such a thing. Or the atheist that would just say, see, that's justification, that your God is just this mean and cruel and evil person that hates women. Right? And they'll say all these things, but what reality is happening is that stumbling stone has become a rock of offense unto them because they believe it not. Default, we believe first every word of God. And that allows us to be in the first part of verse 7. Have Christ, have God as our precious one, our chief cornerstone. And we'll never be confounded if we just by default believe. But if we're disobedient and we're disallowing what God is saying here, no wonder that we fall into verse 8. It says, "And a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense, even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient, whereunto also they were appointed. But ye," talking back to the believers, "are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, an holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light." What a great position that God puts you in if you'll just believe. Look, we don't need to understand everything the Bible says. We don't need to apply everything the Bible says to our lives in order to fall in the category of chosen, of royal, of holy, of peculiar. God asks one thing of that group, and that's believe. And if you believe, he's precious. If you believe, you won't be confounded. If you believe, you're chosen, you're royal, you're holy, you're peculiar, you're separate and distinct unto God. And therefore, you won't be offended. You won't stumble. You won't be confounded by even words of God that are set there. And I believe, I'm a believer, that some things in the Bible are there to simply be a stumbling stone and a rock of offense. And I can take application of that from something like John chapter 6, where Jesus eventually said to his disciples, "Will ye also go away?" Why? Because he was preaching that they, as men, ought have to eat his flesh and drink his blood. And they're like, "I don't understand that." They ought to have taken the position that, "I believe what you're saying, though I don't understand that," and therefore stayed with him like the 12 did. They didn't go away. Why? Because they said, "Thou hast the words of eternal life. Where can we go?" And we have to have the same thing. Something we read in Deuteronomy 21 seems to be offensive to our 2020 mind, Where can I go? Thou hast the words of eternal life. And so we look to that and we just believe it, and God will allow us to never be confounded because we've entered into that faith relationship with Him. Okay, so we don't believe it, but nevertheless, we shouldn't stumble over it. Go back to Deuteronomy 21. Now, the other thing that's interesting about this is because they all want to bring up an argument like this and something from Deuteronomy and say, oh, that's horrible and demeaning to women. But get this. Why are we worried about something like this? When is this scenario ever practically going to play out in your life? Okay? We worry about something like this, and how is this just, and how is this righteous, and how is this what God would want in a scenario? All the while, we're missing the point that on the basis level, at the lowest cookie shelf, right? Who's ever going to war against an enemy and bringing home all of these casualties of war, and then looking to a beautiful woman and saying, I'm going to marry her, and then taking her home and having her shave her head and pare her nails, and then discovering maybe just because she's an heathen and an unbeliever and she has all sorts of strange things going on in her world, they discover that after the fact because it looks like they just kind of noticed they were beautiful and got home and they're like, whoa, she's a witch or something like that. Who knows what the scenario is, but I would say it's probably pretty extreme. They discovered something pretty extreme. He put her away because of it, but he didn't sell her. He didn't make any money. He just said, you're free to go. Okay? So when is that ever going to happen? When it does, though, you got a Bible verse to go to on how to deal with it. Okay? But for now, we just read it. We just believe it. We just try to meditate upon these things, and that can help you. You can sit around and look at these four verses and ask God and pray after God and see how this applies to you now. And I think it does. I think there's truth to it, but maybe that's the truth right there. Maybe we just found application in 1 Peter 2 that we ought not stumble over that. Just believe it. Just trust that word and just know that God is holy, God is righteous, God is just. He put that there for a reason, and don't be like the rest of John 6:66 that just turned and followed him no more because they're offended at the word. No, just say, hey, it is what it is. It says what it says. God meant it. I believe it. That settles it. And then carry on. And you know what you can do? You can just go to the next verse. Right? Don't let yourself stumble. Don't let unbelievers force you to stumble over words of God like this. Don't get caught in these arguments. Just say, hey, I believe it. If you don't like it, it doesn't matter. I don't believe my Bible because somebody else likes it, because the whole world likes it. It's not popular. Jesus wasn't popular. Okay? So we just need to believe it and just move on. No need to get involved in vain jagglings and arguments of these types of things. Don't worry about it. Just believe it and don't stumble.